We will now call the September 14th Caribou City Council meeting to order. And unless any councilors have any objection, I'd like to swap 5 and 6 on the agenda tonight. Just in case our Haven Enterprises doesn't want to sit through the whole school proposal, so. And if they do, we'd be glad to have them stay. All right, public input. Anyone that has any input tonight on any of the agenda items or anything else that they'd like to bring to council's attention? Please step forward to the microphone if you do. No? Okay. Not working?
Yeah, here.
It's supposed to be up?
Yep, it's on.
Are you up?
Yep.
Any conflicts of interest from any city council regarding any agenda items tonight?
Number 9.
Number 6. Well, is it, or 5, the abatement request?
Yeah. Okay. Consider authorizing minutes of the following meetings: August the 10th, 2015, City Council meeting, and June 11th, 2015, Secession Public Hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councilor McDonough, seconded by Councilor Smith. All those in favor? Approved. Consent agenda, we have the August Fire Department report, the August Library report, July 2015 financials, July and August 2015 Police Department reports, CDBG Advisory Committee, and November election. Any questions or comments about any of those items?
Move the slate.
Second.
Moved by Councilor McDonough, seconded by Councilor Terrio to move the slate of the consent agenda. All those in favor? Approved. And now we're going to switch these to 5 and 6 here, so we'll go to number 6. Abatement request from Haven Enterprises. Mr. Blease?
On the following pages is an abatement request from Haven Enterprises for their property at 24 Sweden Street. During the reveal, it appears there was a clerical mistake made by RJD that classified the property as residential and not commercial. After discussing with MMA Legal, they've stated because this does appear to be a clerical mistake by RJD, they would qualify for an abatement under 36 MRSA Section 841. The statute is listed there. It says that the municipal officers, the city council, either upon written application filed after 1 year but within 3 years from commitment stating the grounds for an abatement or on their own initiative within that time period may make such reasonable abatements. It goes on there. As commitment happened on July 1st of each year, this means the council can only go back and abate the taxes for 2013 and 2014. There's nothing in the state statute that would allow the council to abate the taxes for 2012 as being requested. The Board of Assessors met last week. They abated the requested amount for the 2015 taxes. On the desk in front of the council this evening is a letter from Haven Enterprises that we received this morning, and also a response from MMA Legal, which explains more fully why we cannot abate 2012. We could only look at the 2013-2014 taxes.
I have a question. If the let's say it was a reverse situation, the mistake was the other way. Could we go back to collect if we were owed taxes for more than?
I don't believe so.
Mayor.
Yeah, Councilor Martin.
The letter from Pavin says the statute does allow. Cheryl, can you, where did you get your information?
Out of the MRSA statute.
that language, that you can go back 3 years? I thought the city could go back 3 years to collect taxes, too. That's my understanding.
But does the 3 years mean 12, 13, 14, or 13, 14, 15?
Well, it would mean 12, 13, 14, except for the commitment date for the city of Caribou was always July 1st. So if we had found this on June 30th, we could go back 3 years. Thing is, we didn't find it until August because we thought everything was fine. That's why.
State statute says it's very clear it's 3 years from commitment.
So we can't.
What? I don't know if I'm allowed to talk. You asked me questions, so I guess I can. But you can abate any amount that you want. I don't know what the letter Austin got from MMA says, but you could actually abate any amount that you want. You can abate less than we ask for, you can abate more than we ask for. The city council can abate any amount they want. They're not precluded from abating any amount.
I don't think it's stated, but I think the understanding is up to the full amount. I'm guessing that.
Did the letter you get indicate anything about that, Austin?
I don't know that the council would want to abate a higher amount than what should have been assessed.
What?
I don't know what grounds the council would use to justify that abatement, I guess.
What about the, every now and then we abate taxes from 5-6 years ago? I know it's different. It's not a refund. It's something we're never going to collect.
Right.
Are we using the wrong terminology when we do that?
Personal property.
Right. It's typically personal property that we abate. It's different set of ground rules. Perhaps write-off would be better. It's uncollectible at that point.
So even, well, beyond the 3 years, you couldn't collect it anyway, is what you're saying?
Personal property taxes, it's a six-year window. After 6 years, it's uncollectible.
After six.
You have to take it to small claims court before that. Whereas property taxes, after 3 years, you would tax acquire it. So,
does that go for the commitment date?
The personal property taxes?
No, the fact that the city can collect taxes for that 3 years.
After 3 years, it becomes city-owned property. It becomes tax acquired.
So, Austin, what are you telling us our hands are tied here, really?
Under state statute, there's something that the council could do for 2012.
I'll make a motion that we abate the 13 and 14 taxes.
Second.
Second.
Question.
Councilor Mark.
Can the Board of Assessors do something?
They can only do it within 1 year from commitment. So they're the only taxes in
the They've done the 2015 already.
Right.
My previous question about, you know, if there was a mistake made and they owe more than what they've been paying, can we go back 2 years on that or 3 years on that, you know?
No.
Not if we've assessed something for lands and buildings.
Now, if there was a clerical error, I'm looking at this.
If it's a clerical error, no, we cannot.
Okay. I'm just trying to find out if there's two different sets of ground rules here.
Don't apply anyway.
All right, well, we have a motion on the floor in a second.
Is there a dollar amount or a value amount?
Yes, there was.
The two together, I can tell you what those two together are.
Yeah, I don't know what the two
right here.
So,
$55.89.68.
So, be the $2,912
and 13.
Yeah,
14.
2013, $26.77.30, and 2014, $29.12.38. By the 2 years that are in the motion. Any other questions, comments? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
passed. Sorry.
Sucks.
Next item is the EDT architects have a presentation on the RSU school project. They promise not to be longer than 5 hours.
It'll be quicker than that. We have to go back to Portland. Thank you for giving us time before you. My name's Lyndon Keck. I'm a senior partner with PDT Architects, and I'm the managing partner for this project for RSU 39. We wrote a letter to Austin dated August 21st that outlined some property issues that we have regarding what is now the building committee's first choice as a school site for a new consolidated K-8 building project. Today's discussion, today's presentation, we wanted to go over a little bit of the history of the project for the council and let you know what we know and what we've learned by meeting with the Department of Education, the Department of Facilities and Building Construction at the Department of Education, and also share with you components of the first choice site as it relates to ownership of property. Some of the parcels at the Teague Park School site are presently owned by the City of Caribou. Some of them are owned by RSU 39. And what we're trying to do is put together a parcel that's large enough to be able to accommodate a consolidated K-8 school with the appropriate playgrounds, appropriate athletic fields, and enough space for parking, bus drop-off, and separate parent drop-off. The state standards for a K-8 school would allow for a site as large as 32 and a half acres for a 750 pupil school. What we're envisioning here is something quite a bit less than that. What we're looking for is acreage in the vicinity of 15 to 18 acres of land. We think we can do a nice in-town school with that amount of acreage. My firm just recently completed a school in the town of Brunswick for 600 students, and we did that on a 12-acre parcel. It was an in-town site. The town of Brunswick didn't want to build the school out of town. They wanted to build it in town, so they wanted to encourage walkers and students to use bicycles to an in-town site. Very briefly, I thought I'd just give the council a little history of the project. This project is number 10 on a list of 75 schools that submitted for state financial assistance for building schools. The state has approved 11 of those 72 schools to proceed with planning, and the State Department of Education would be a major financial partner in the building of this project. One of the things I wanted to stress here tonight, the diagrams that I'm going to show you are not set in concrete. Everything is abstract right now. What we have done is we've done what are called test fits on the Teague Park site to see if indeed we think we can make a school work there. But we have not designed a building. The Department of Education is not committed to anything that I show you tonight. The other thing is that from the Department of Education standpoint, they really are looking to have a project that RSU 39 wants and that the City of Caribou wants. So they see this as a partnership deal. So they want this to be a win-win for all of the stakeholders. Stakeholders would be the City of Caribou, would be RSU 39, would be the parents would be the Attorney General's office in this case, because the Attorney General's office has an interest in protecting the deed components of Teague Park proper. And another stakeholder would be the Department of Parks and Conservation that also has some restrictions on Teague Park land, as well as the Teague Park school land. And some of those issues I've outlined for the council in my letter to Austin on August 21st. So I wanted to give you a very brief history of kind of where the project has been at. I brought some boards to try to do that. We've done a number of different studies. One of the studies we did was a site search study in the city of Caribou. The building committee really wanted this because 83% of the students that go to this school will be Caribou students. The building committee and the RSU board really wanted us to focus our attention on selecting a site within the boundaries of the city of Caribou. We looked at 10 sites and narrowed it down to 6 sites. And of those 6 sites, our firm made a recommendation to the building committee. We ranked them, we scored them on a matrix with civil engineers. And the school that scored the most point, the site that scored the most points was Teague Park Elementary School site, which is located right here. As you know, that's basically along Bennett Drive on one side, and then it has Park Street on the other that goes between the middle school and Teague Park. Other sites, the number 2 site in terms of scoring on the matrix was the Hilltop site. And then 3, 4, 5, and 6 were scored, and they went downhill after that. The building committee endorsed site 1 as their first choice, site 2, Hilltop, as their second choice, and the Van Buren site as their third choice for sites. So what we're doing right now is we're investigating how realistic is it for us to really develop site number 1, which is the in-town site of Teague Park's school. We also did a new versus renovation study, and I know the newspaper has reported on the results of that, but we made a recommendation to the Department of Education and to the building committee that we thought this should be a new school project because of the age of the existing buildings. Hilltop is 55 years old. Teague Park Elementary School is 65 years old, and then the Caribou Middle School is 89 years old. There are always increased efficiencies and lower operational costs if you build a new 21st century school than if you would run 3 older schools. So this is really seen as an opportunity to have substantial savings for the RSU operationally by bringing 3 schools together. I also brought some boards that show the overview of the Teague Park site. Sent to Austin, and the council members have in front of you, there's several parcels that make up the site that we've looked at here. We've done a series of different test pits, We've done 5 different test fits, looking at different places of possibly locating the school in this area with Bennett Drive in the middle. So Bennett Drive is here. This is Park, and then Glen runs up the backside over here. For people that don't know, on Glen Street, across from the Teague Park Elementary School, is the bus garage, where maintenance occurs and where the buses are always housed at the end of the day. So the parcels, as I go through them, Parcel A is owned by the City of Caribou, and Parcel A presently has your pool and as well as the changing rooms for the pool. and that has 2.6 acres located here, and the credit union parcel has been cut out here, so that's the credit union building. This is one of the parcels that we're interested in. Parcel B is the Teague Park Elementary School site. This is where the school presently sits, and that has 4.8 acres. Parcel C is Teague Park itself. That land was given to the City of Caribou in 1897, 118 years ago. It does have restrictions on it in terms of its continued use, how the land can be used. The next site is the middle school site, parcel D, which is the middle school. It's 3.33 acres. And then there's a small parcel called parcel E, which is the driveway that comes off of Bennett Drive and goes into the middle school. That's actually owned by the City of Caribou. It's not owned by the RSU. And that is seven one-hundredths of an acre. The next possible parcel is parcel H, which is Park Street. That's presently a city street that runs between Glen and Bennett. And that has roughly 5.68 acres of land. Parcel F across the street is where the Learning Center is. That's a former elementary school. It's now where the headquarters for RSU 39 is. And also the educational programs as well as run out of the Learning Center. And then the last parcel on this exhibit is parcel G, which has the Caribou Wellness and Recreation Center, which has 6.2 acres. So if I just go up and I count up the acreage for A, B, C, D, and E, that adds up to a little over 17 acres of land. If you add parcel F, which is the Learning Center, that's another 6.3 acres, which would bring us up to 23.4 acres of land if we used all of that land. We don't know that we need all of the land, and as I said, we've done some test fits and considered whether or not which parcels we need to put together to sort of make a school work. What I can tell you is that we've looked at putting the school on parcel F, and there's just not enough land for the school with playgrounds and with bus drop-off and with parent drop-off. That parcel is only 6.3 acres, and we cannot put those elements together on the school. It's important to really have the playgrounds directly adjacent to the school. We wouldn't want to have students running across Bennett Drive just to use a playground. And obviously, we need to have the bus drop-off and the parent drop-off located at the same location as the school. That was one of the first things we looked at, as we said, would it be possible to have the school located on parcel F alone? And the answer was no. We then looked across the street, and we realized that all of these parcels individually are smaller than parcel F. And that's when we realized we probably really need to think about putting together a series of parcels to make a good-sized school project. Teague Park Elementary School site is 6.6 acres, so it's very similar to the Learning Center. We know that we can't get the footprint for this consolidated school, plus playgrounds, plus bus drop-off, plus parent drop-off. We cannot get all of those elements on that small of a site. What I am going to show you is a test fit, and I think it's in the package that I sent the council members. It's one of the five test fits that we did do. And what we did is we said, what would happen if we took all of these pieces of land and put them together? How would the school lay out? So this is Bennett Drive, located here. Here's Glen Street. The middle school is presently located here. It's dotted in on that drawing. Teague Park Elementary School sits right about where the laser pointer is now. And then the Learning Center is across the street over here, and it's dotted in that location there. So on this test fit, we laid out a building. We think the building's going to be about between 115 and 120,000 square feet of space. We haven't designed the building yet because we really need to have a site before we really start to design the building. But what we did do is we took 120,000 square feet, we made assumptions about what size the footprint would be, and the red element represents a hypothetical building that has the right size footprint for 120,000 square foot building. Sure.
What's the combined footprint of Teague Park and the middle school?
6.6 acres.
No, the footprint of those two buildings together.
Oh, those two buildings together. I've got that in a study that in my briefcase.
Is it more than?
It's less than this.
Than that?
Yes.
Is that a one-story building or two?
What this represents is a two-story building.
So you need 115,000 square feet, two stories?
No, I'm sorry. The 115 to 120,000 square feet is the total gross square footage. It's not the footprint. The footprint's smaller than 115 to 120. The total gross, whether it's a two-story building or a three-story building, we're going to need roughly 115 to 120,000 square feet of space. You're asking me about the footprint, right? Yeah.
Wouldn't it get smaller if you go higher?
Absolutely. If it's a three-story building, this footprint will get slightly smaller. But there are always a certain number of elements that we always have to put on the first floor. Gymnasiums, cafeterias. Pre-kindergarten, and first graders always have to be located on the first floor. Generally, it's about 60% of a building has to be located on the first floor. So on this represents roughly the footprint for a two-story building. We've got a bus drop-off loop located here off of Glen Street. And cars would not be allowed in the bus drop-off. We've got car drop-off for parents located here, coming off of Glen Street, and then another parent drop-off located here that runs between Bennett and Glen Street. And then there's visitor parking under these trees right here. It's a 45-degree angle parking here. And then there's staff parking located in this parking lot located here. We've got... We show playgrounds on this side of the school. And then on this particular test fit, we kept the softball field that presently exists on Teague Park. We kept the two tennis courts located here. And then we assumed we would rebuild the basketball courts and we would build two new tennis courts located here. That's because at Teague Park presently, there's two tennis courts located here. On this test fit, we closed Park Street, and then we made this green space, which is where the middle school is located. We made that part of a continuous, non-interrupted by vehicles, opportunity for green space to run from this end of the elementary school over to this end of the site on the south. We also put more parking located here to be used by these elements, and also to be extra overflow parking for events for the school or for the Wellness and Recreation Center. The other thing this scheme did is it built three new fields across the street where the Learning Center presently is. We believe the Department of Education will approve somewhere between two and three athletic fields for a school this size, serving grades pre-K through 8. So new elements would be the elementary school, new playground, and then three new athletic fields. We also show a fourth field over here shown where the middle school presently exists. So what we know is that when we did this test fit, you take land from the city of Caribou to make this test fit work. Although we haven't actually decided who would retain ownership of these components. What I do know is that Department of Education will pay for improvements made on land that the RSU 39 has clear title for, so that we will need to acquire, if we're going to make this site work, we're going to need to acquire some additional land, and obviously the city of Caribou has that additional land adjacent to the Teak Park Elementary School. We did look at other test fits. We looked at test fits that did not close Park Street. We looked at test fits that looked at the possibility of using the backside of the Wellness and Recreation Center where you presently have the National Guard. We looked at a test fit there to have an athletic field located there. And then we looked at a test fit where a new Teague Parks park would be established as being established where the middle school presently is. So it's conceivable that what is now called Teague Park could be transferred to this piece of land over here. All of this is really a partnership piece between the RSU 39 and the city of Caribou. There are other encumbrances on the land, however, that I wanted to make the council aware of, and it's included in the letter that you all have in front of you. And that is that over the years, the city of Caribou has accepted grant money, that's National Park Service money, through the Land Conservation Bureau at the state of Maine in Augusta. And so that there are easements that will protect acreage and the use of certain improvements that have been made over the years to Teague Park as well as the Teague Park Elementary School. So those improvements include the softball field, the tennis courts, the basketball courts, and then there's presently a playground for the Teague Park Elementary School that was also improved with National Park Service grant money. And I'll show you where those encumbrances are on the site. So this is at a different scale, it's a larger scale. So here's the formal Teague Park. Here's Teague Park Elementary School. The property line between Teague Park and the elementary school is roughly in this area. And there was formerly a street here, I think it was called North Street. And at some point the city closed North Street and that land then became a part of Teague Park. As near as I can tell, there were two different grants that were granted to make improvements to Teague Park. Included the softball field and then another grant, I think, for the tennis courts in the elementary school. But a third grant was given more recently for playground improvements. And those playground improvements actually have been made on the Teague Park Elementary School site. So we have been working and talking with Gary at the Department of Recreation Department about these encumbrances. Our firm has also had instances where we've worked on city-owned land where there were these kinds of grant encumbrances. And in the past, what we were able to do was to replace these kinds of improvements somewhere else on another parcel of land. We had an instance where we had four tennis courts on a city-owned piece of land, and an elementary school needed to be expanded, and we rebuilt the tennis courts on another piece of city-owned land. But there are two components to the encumbrances that are on the land here. One is that there needs to be open space that's dedicated for public use in terms of acreage, and there also need to be similar kinds of improvements that are kept open to the public. So that's why earlier I said that the state of Maine, in terms of the parks and conservation, Department Bureau. They haven't, they're a stakeholder here because they have an interest in the encumbrances that they have on these parcels of land. So that's an overview of what I think the situation is. What I'll do is I'll put the parcel drawing up again that shows the parcels that we're interested in. So I have with me here this evening is the Superintendent of Schools, Tim Doakes. He's the new Superintendent of Schools. I also have Bill Stockmeyer, who's an attorney with Drummond Woodsum. They're the attorneys for the school district, and Bill Stockmeyer also has done a lot of legal research on the deeds for these parcels, and he has a lot of personal history in his legal background in terms of dealing with these kinds of situations. Anyway, we're here tonight. I want to explain to you myself where we're at with the project. We're at a point where we need to make a decision whether Teague Park site makes sense to continue with or whether we should move to the Hilltop site. I will tell you that the Department of Education thinks that the Teague Park site is an ideal site. Department of Education likes to see schools built in the center of communities. They prefer not to build schools outside of town. And they also see a strong connection between the Health, Wellness, and Recreation Center and the school. That's also something that the building committee saw. Presently, you've got the Teague Park students as well as the middle school students walking across Bennett Drive using all the programs that are available at the Wellness and Recreation Center. So it seems like a good symbiotic relationship between the Health and Wellness Center and the school. And having an in-town site seemed to us and seemed to the Department of Education like an ideal site for the school. But we're here to listen to the council, to hear about your concerns and your views on what I've shared. But before I take those questions, I just want to explain again that we think we have flexibility if indeed the city of Caribou is willing to work with us in terms of looking at the possibility of having some of the land committed to the school site. That's it from you.
So some of the, you're mentioning like the ball field to remain and some of that area would still be open to the public?
Well, on that test fit, yeah.
In the tennis court.
Right. The truth is, as I said, we've done five test fits, and we've looked at a lot of different kinds of things, and we're not sure where all the right pieces go. And what we really think is that we should be having a conversation with you and the Recreation Department and the Department of Education to sort of figure out which parcels make the most sense and where those functions should be. If this was all green virgin land here, I'm not sure I would put tennis courts and a softball field located in this location. We've kept them there on this test fit, but we had other test fits where we moved the tennis courts across the street and we rebuilt them across the street where the learning center is. We had another test fit where we took the softball field and we relocated it over here where the middle school presently is. So we have flexibility in terms of where the pieces are located. But on this particular test fit, we said, let's see what we can do to try to preserve the elements that are presently on Teague Park. The thing that we're not particularly comfortable with, and I think I need Bill Stockmeyer to talk to this a little more, is that I think this wants to become school RSU 39 land rather than City of Caribou land. And then to your question, I'm not sure that the RSU 39 can grant the same 24/7 access to the softball field and to the tennis courts as the city of Caribou can. And I think if you look at what the deed restrictions are for Teague Park, I think it was to be made available at any time for any member of the public. With school sites, There are times, especially when the children are out on the fields and out in the playgrounds, when you don't want non-school personnel around them. And in fact, ideally as a school site, we would want to build a fence along Bennett Drive because we don't want kids accidentally running into Bennett Drive. But in this case, we did leave these elements here just to see what it would mean if we had sort of a minimally invasive approach. The other thing is that the tennis courts could be used by middle schoolers, but tennis courts are not really of much use to small elementary school kids. And maybe if the tennis courts are used a lot by the public, we thought maybe the tennis courts should be across the street adjacent to the Wellness and Recreation Center. So we have the opportunity to move those pieces around.
Can we back way up here for a minute? You talked about storing on these different sites. And, I mean, you said that this was the number one site. Hilltop was the number two and so on. What is the difference in the scores? I mean, are we talking big differences between this site is that much better than another one? Or?
It's a great question. I'm not sure I can read from here. I don't have a remote microphone. I hate getting old. So this is the matrix that was developed. And the way it happened is that we suggested a list of criteria for the building committee, and the building committee expanded the list of criteria. That was done before we scored the sites. So before we went out and looked at sites, the building committee and our firm and the civil engineers that work for us came up with, we said, all right, these are the criteria that we want to score sites by. And we also gave them priority ranges, and some things were given more higher points than other things. And then we scored the 6 points. So I'm going to bring the board over, and then I'll read them out loud for you. And there's a public camera there, so I'm going to hold it up for you. That'd be great. So the other thing is that for all the members of the public that are interested in following this project, the RSU 39 does have a link on their website, so you can keep track of all of the meetings that we have and all of the exhibits that we've prepared. You can go to their website and you can see this stuff yourself. So RSU 39, the rating range was a maximum number of points was 330. Teague's Park School site got 257. Hilltop School got 202 points. The site on Lombard Road got 167. The high school got 171. Van Buren Road site got 158. And then there was a site on South Main Street that got 139. So a maximum possible of 330. Teague Park got 257, and then the Hilltop got 202. And just an example of what the items are, the rating criteria, proximity to established residential neighborhoods and abutting properties, zoning and planning compliance, abutting property compatibility, usable land percentage, bus route compatibility, topography, low slope, suitable soils, three-phase power access, reasonable stormwater management, soil orientation, lead site potential, likely hazardous material contamination, deed restrictions, demolition costs, potential for outdoor learning environments, and operational efficiencies.
Is this information on the RSU 39 site?
Should be. This part is happening.
Should be. Yes, Mark says yes. The business manager says yes.
What's it called? Site selection?
This is the site selection, and it's the site rating matrix. I can also provide copies for the council if you'd like copies.
I'd like to have a copy of myself.
Absolutely, sure.
What's the estimated cost of this proposal?
Of the school?
Yeah.
No price has been done. It'll be tens of millions of dollars, though.
Tens
but
of
we don't have, yeah.
It's fully funded by the state?
Well, that is, I'm going to ask Bill to get up and explain that. He's the lawyer that understands school financing. It's different in different communities based on what their level of indebtedness is, and Bill's going to do a better job of explaining that than I will.
So he's going to cover that?
Yeah. You want to do it now?
Sure.
Okay. And I'm happy to leave this tonight for the council if you want to have that to look at.
Hi, I'm Bill Stockmeyer. Under the state's essential programs and services funding model, certain costs of running the schools qualify for state subsidy and certain costs don't. So we'll start with that. If this project is approved, the project could have all of its elements, the debt service on all of its elements included for purposes of state subsidy, or there could be certain elements that don't qualify for state subsidy. And those things are usually things like excess land costs and certain elements the state doesn't care to participate in. The ones I generally see are a larger cafetorium than the state will agree to participate in, or certain other elements the local communities want that the state says that's fine, but we're not going to participate in those. So let's put aside those elements and assume that your land costs all qualify for state subsidy, and that the elements of it, you don't have any extra elements that the state says we don't participate in. So assuming all the elements of the project, and some for a number of projects that is the case, and for other projects the communities say no, we want this even if it's at local expense. So assuming all the elements have qualified for state subsidy, the question becomes, what's the local tax impact? And obviously, so we have to understand the state funding formula could change. The state could adjust the formula. You know, different things happen over time. But under the current formula and under the current subsidy level, all three of your communities are paying the maximum local cost share expectation, which you think of as the maximum tax effort. I had someone read me the amounts over the phone, so I speak from memory, but I believe something like $50 million currently in costs qualify for state subsidy. Of those, $12 million are allocated to Caribou. Caribou can afford about $3 million. That's the maximum local cost share expectation that Caribou has to pay for those costs that qualify for state subsidy. That means if new costs qualify for state subsidy, the state, you're already paying the maximum, the state picks up the difference. So if let's just take $1 million a year in extra debt service subsidy, if that's assigned to Caribou, Caribou will still be paying $3 million of the $12 million, except it'll now be $3 million of $13 million. So will Caribou be paying something? It'll be paying $3 million of $13 million instead of $3 million of $12 million, but $3 is $3 in terms of what it's paying. So depending on how you look at it, the project, and assuming the state subsidy level stays the same, and assuming you don't have extra elements that don't qualify at all, the state doesn't want to participate in, it should be a state-funded project, not a locally funded project.
How do we know if there's extra elements as this process moves along? Because, as everybody said, we don't know what it is today.
Right.
We don't know what the building's going to be like or anything else. So how do we know if there's extra elements and if everybody's in agreement?
Sure. Well, right now you don't know. Part of that is discretionary with the folks. Ultimately, it will all go to the voters for approval. So if there are such extra elements, then
I'm in the design. When you get further into the design here,
then you might actually
design every year. Elements, would it not?
Yeah, it's my turn.
But we want an indoor pool like limestone.
That's an extra element. You got it. You got right to the point. Hockey rinks are extra. A larger gym is extra. And so the answer to your question is the building committee works with the architect in terms of determining what are the elements they want to put in the building, and the Department of Education will determine whether or not they're going to pay for something. So the building committee every month will be negotiating basically with the Department of Education, determining what the Department of Education will pay for and what they won't.
I have one other financial question. along with the state subsidies, are there any federal funds involved in this process, or is it all subsidized by the state?
Not aware of any federal funding of this project. Also, I mentioned the referendum. Prior to that, there are, Lyndon, is it two straw votes?
Right.
At the more conceptual stage, the building committee and the architect sort of take the temperature of the public and whether they do or don't want extra elements. Part of that process involves a couple of non-binding straw polls in a public hearing context to help them gauge that, because no one wants to get to a referendum and have it not pass.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So just to add on to that question, some of the, you know, concepts that I know they're just preliminary at now, but there's some concepts here that require some city infrastructure, not to move the pool, some fields. Is that, are those extra elements?
I'm just trying to figure out whether they even cover that or not.
No, I'm trying to, I'm not sure I understood the question.
What he's saying is we're going to lose our pool and we're going to lose our field. So
oh.
What happens there? I mean, does that part of the project become doing this somewhere else for the city of Caribou?
Yeah, is that included in the cost? Is that an extra element that...
Some elements would be, the Department of Education would replace, others they would not. They would not replace the pool, for instance. I don't think the pool is operational right now. I don't know what the long-term prognosis is on the pool. But they would not replace the pool. But they would. One of the things they will do is they will pay for demolition. They'll pay for the demolition of the buildings. Tea Park Elementary School, the middle school, and the learning center as well. They'll develop the fields that I've shown you, and if we needed to rebuild two tennis courts, they would pay for the rebuilding of the two tennis courts. They see this as a partnership. They want to do their fair share. But there are limits to what they will spend money on.
Sure.
And I understand that. I mean, you made that comment before, too, about this is a, you know, hopefully a win-win deal, the citizens of Caribou and the RSU and so on and so forth, and you want everyone to be involved and, you know, like what's coming down the pipe here. And I guess I have to ask the question, did you ever hold any public hearings where you gave the people in Caribou the chance to come forward and say what they think this should be like or what should be done or even more so where it should be?
Yeah, well, that's all coming. You know, we're not asking for...
Do you think that should have been done earlier?
Well, right. Actually...
This concept stage?
Well, we had to get to this point to understand if something was even feasible before we had something to show to the public. But to your point...
The only reason I say that is... And I'm going to make a guess here, but I think it's probably pretty close. I'd say 70% of the people that have talked to me about this new school have said it should be out where the high school is so everything is together. Probably 70% of the people that have talked to me have said that. I'm not sure if any have suggested Teague Park, in all honesty. So that's why I'm kind of wondering why, you know, why there wouldn't be public meetings to before. I mean, there's obviously been a fair amount of work gone into this. And many configurations, as you said, about how to do it and what we could do.
Yeah, well, the public's going to have an opportunity to talk. The Department of Education's attitude is they want a site search done. They want to be convinced that we've had an opportunity to look at all the viable sites and that we've evaluated them using an objective criteria. We are doing public meetings the first week of October. In all three towns, as well as obviously Caribou. And as Bill said, as the project moves forward, and if indeed this site, if the stakeholders all agree that this is the right site to develop, and we get a final a sense of how we're going to make the parcels work, then there'll be a public hearing, and there'll be a straw vote of... So it's an opportunity for the public to come out and say whether they support the site or they don't support the site. So we had to do a lot of work
before we can really go to the public. It's not a matter, the Department of Education doesn't want us to just hold a public meeting and ask people where they want the site, and then people say, oh, well, we want the site here, because the Department of Education might say, what are the other choices? And has an objective study been done that determines what's, quote-unquote, the highest scoring site? So we'll do the public meetings. We're happy to do those public meetings.
Councilor Martin?
Two things. First one, this sounds like what we went through with the Army Corps of Engineers when they asked us, where do you want it? And we said, there. And they came back and said, no, it's going to be here. So if the state's going to decide this, I don't know. But do you know what's going to happen when you go to Limestone with this project? They're going to say, what are you, closing our school? I mean, why are you going to Limestone?
Because they're voting members of the RSU 39, and we're not closing their school. But they do. They will vote on this project. They will be allowed to vote on the project, and so all three towns, we need to make the same presentation to all three towns. The taxpayers there deserve an opportunity to, because they're part of the RSU 39 schools, have an opportunity to vote on the project.
We won't vote for any of the extra elements.
I don't know who wants to recognize people.
I actually have serious reservations about giving up our park. We didn't open the skating rink last winter, but there is a skating rink there. Would there be another place that there would be a skating rink? Should we want to open up a skating rink in another year or so? I still have serious reservations about the pool. I don't know that we've actually decided that we're going to demolish it. I don't know what we've actually decided about that. And a little area that you said might be able to be the park, that doesn't look as big as what we have now. So I'm really concerned about giving up the park. Plus, I am one of those that agree that the high school location really should be looked at, and the buildings should all be consolidated maybe into one section. But
yeah,
makes sense to me for transportation, for busing, for people picking up their kids, things like that. So
yeah, we'll tell you quite honestly, when we looked at the high school, there isn't enough land there to put a K-8 school,
and you can't
with the supporting fields.
Purchase land in
We looked at the Carl Soderberg owns adjacent parcels. There was one parcel he was willing to consider selling, and we did take that into consideration when we evaluated the high school site. We added that parcel, and we still couldn't get everything on the site. He does own land behind, on the other side of the ski areas. What's the name of that road? Lombard?
Lombard.
Lombard Road. Lombard Road, though, doesn't have public utilities that we really need in terms of sewer, water, and three-phase electric, and he really is not interested in selling that land. He said, if nothing else works, come back and talk to me. But he said, yes, I own that land, but I am not interested in selling it. I think he has made a major investment in a ski course that runs behind the high school there. And he's really not interested in having that ruined by having roads and driveways run through the ski course. He was gracious enough to let us put it on the matrix and score it as a standalone site, but it would not accomplish what I think you want it to accomplish, which is the feel of a nice consolidated campus that would be pre-kindergarten through 12th grade. We've heard other comments as well from people that advocated for the high school site. Our firm has done a lot of campuses. Scarborough and Wyndham are campus sites, and they have advantages and they have disadvantages, and unfortunately there isn't as much land at the high school as you would like to think there is. As I said, there's an opportunity here to really build fields for the elementary school kids as well as for the middle school, because the middle school right now really doesn't have much in terms of athletic fields. They really have just that softball field that's part of Teague Park.
Councilor McDonough, I think
he can go.
Councilor Martin.
I'll go next.
What happens to the learning center?
Yeah, there's no definitive answer, but the logical one that's been talked about so far by the building committee and the superintendents have been that those functions would probably move to the Hilltop building. Hilltop school building. Hilltop would stay. So what you would do is you would demolish the middle school, Teague Park Elementary School, and the learning center.
There's no room at the high school for those activities?
No, we did test fits, and I'll be happy to make them available to the council. What we're basically doing is adding three new athletic fields. A lot of the high school, not a lot, a substantial amount of the high school.
That wasn't a question.
Oh, okay.
There's no room at the high school for the activities at the learning center.
Oh, that I don't know. I didn't study that.
That structure, when it was built, was supposed to be large enough for 1,000 people. Plus, they've added on the tech center since then. And I just don't know what happens to all that space over time, especially you have a decreasing student population. So, I mean, are we taking all these things into consideration? You know, and I'm in agreement also with the all-on-one campus. And I don't think anything can't be done. I think it probably could be done, you know. But maybe looking at downsizing.
I think a superintendent like me.
That's okay. No, come on up. Yeah. Our firm didn't look at that, and the building committee hasn't made any decisions. In a sense, it's kind of putting the cart before the horse.
There's no process, and to some of us, it's putting the cart. That's the state of Maine.
In the discussions I've heard, they've talked about the possibility of moving things to Hilltop. That seemed easy. But there may be opportunity. If there's an opportunity at the high school, it should definitely be studied.
Yeah, and we have thought about it. In the short time I've been here, we looked at Hilltop, and we also looked at the high school. And this project doesn't get built in a year. It'll probably be a five or six-year phase. And by then, we probably would be able to maybe condense and be a little bit smaller in the size of the learning center and adult ed. That's what's in. You have adult ed, and you have the alternative school, and then the superintendent's office. But Hilltop just seemed to be a natural fit, but there is going to be room at that point in time at the high school. Yeah.
Carl Sauerberg doesn't want anybody messing with those ski trails. There is not enough land. I mean, if you go where Raymond's farm was and by Raymond's pond, and there's plenty of land, but that's the land he doesn't want to sell. So
the parcel, that's a good point, because the parcel that he did offer is directly adjacent to, I think it's your football field. It goes out on the highway there. And unfortunately, half of that land is wetland area. There's also, as you go down to the ski area, then that become wetland areas that can't be developed by us.
Now I have another question, maybe just for personal satisfaction or anything. You talked about the age of the buildings,
mm-hmm.
and you said that they don't really warrant rehabilitation or whatever. But the high school I went to was built in 1863. It's still there.
What is it, a museum?
It's an active high school that educates 1,000 students a year today. But I don't understand that, I guess. You know, with the technology we have today to improve on existing and older structures, you know, I mean, I understand the consolidation method of it, and I fully agree with that. But I just didn't understand why, if we were looking at rehabilitating the middle school as an example, why the alternative would be to rebuild instead of rehabilitate. That's all.
Go to the middle school, get down in the pit.
I've been there.
And spend an hour there and come back.
I understand that, but I'm just saying that, to me, I think that's still a viable building to use.
To that point, we did do a study. It's rather lengthy, but it's called the New versus Renovation Study. And if you go to that school link, you can read the whole study there that has our engineering analysis and does have an explanation for why we made the decision that we thought new was better than renovation.
You mentioned that going forward that there would be two non-binding straw referendums
right
down the road. Is there any reason to talk about putting the cart before the horse? Could we have a referendum, which is just around the corner, to see if this is what the public wants?
Well, I don't know what you do a referendum. I mean, yeah, you can do whatever you want. The state just mandates, the state insists, and why don't I talk a little bit about the timeline here. The state insists that you do a minimum of 2 straw votes to test the waters, as Bill said, and then by law, the state mandates that all the taxpayers in the 3 towns get to vote on whether or not to approve the bond issue. So it'll be a referendum question. So all the taxpayers get an opportunity to vote on that. The timeline is, and this is the fastest we think the timeline can go, is that we're hoping to have a site selected and a site designed by the end of December so that we could have the straw poll in January, and then we could present the site to the State Board of Education. State Board of Education makes all the final decisions, and they're the final ones that distribute the money on projects. So all the work that we do and that the RSU does ultimately makes its way to the State Board of Education. The next one would be we would be starting design on the building probably in December and do that through the spring, have the design hopefully finished late spring, like May or June. Do cost estimates at the same time and have a project budget, and then be able to have a straw poll on what's called the concept design. Concept design is everything. It's the site that's been selected, the site design, the building design, so you see exactly how big it is, and what's the cost, so people see exactly how much it costs. That straw poll would probably happen in July or August of next year. And then there would be a referendum question in at the general election in November of 2016.
I mean, I know this is a long way out, but what happens in that period when you're building the new school? The old school's got to be down over at Deep Park, right?
Yeah.
If you went with this concept.
Absolutely. And, well, the school department is going to work on, they think they have enough room at Hilltop and at the middle school. To be able to accommodate those students. So they're going to work on an internal plan. But you're absolutely right. If we use this site, the Teague Park Elementary School would have to be demolished on day one.
My only other question, I mean, all the land we're looking at that is owned by the city of Caribou and everything else, which if we give up for this plan, we are going to have to build another park somewhere, I'm sure. Teague Park is well used. I mean, it's really the only softball field in town, is it not? I know the whole softball tournament's not over there. I don't think we have another softball diamond. We have baseball diamonds.
The only other softball diamond we have is on the high school campus.
Yeah, well, you can't use that.
Yeah.
Well, when we...
It's all the same town. We're acting like it's two separate...
Well, when we finish the project, maybe I haven't been clear, but... If indeed this site is developed, when we finish the project, there will be a softball field there. There will be 4 tennis courts, and there will be 2 basketball courts.
Yeah.
And the state of Maine will have paid to make sure that that happens.
But they are not open to for city use.
Well, I think it depends where they're located and who owns the land where those are located.
Oh, okay.
That's why I'm saying they're movable.
I thought you can't get approval for making the improvements.
On non...
Because you doesn't own the land. Isn't that a comment made earlier?
That was. But it has to do with whether or not it's a new element built on a new parcel of land or whether it's on an existing piece of land. So that's part of what we have to work out with the Department of Education. We ideally want to come up with a plan that works for the city of Caribou, works for the RSU, and then we present it with the state of Maine and have them look at it and work with it and say, yeah, we can pay for this, or no, we can't pay for this. So it's a moving target.
Councilor Martin.
I don't have a problem with building in Teague Park. I have a problem, and if we give you all that land, we have none left. I notice in your drawing you got the splash pad in the addition to the wellness center. I mean, where would we put a pool, let's say?
Well, maybe more land needs to be dedicated as City of Caribou land. As I said, this is a test fit. It's not a final plan. Well, and so maybe that's what I'm learning tonight is that there needs to be more land in the overall plan.
How many steps do we need to do to finalize a site? How many more steps are involved? Because right now, the way I'm listening here, what I hear is that there's still six sites that are still being investigated. It just happens to be that this one is top of the list.
We're not doing any more investigation on the other six. This is the top of the list, and so we're going to work as hard as we can to see if we can make this site work. Okay. But the answer to your question is we'll work on this site trying to make it work as long as it looks viable. We don't have a time limit. The Department of Education hasn't said, you have to get this done in 60 days. If it takes a year, it'll take a year. If we can get it done in 3 months, we'll finish it in 3 months.
I think if you move that ball field to where the middle school is now, mm-hmm. move the parking lot so my man Pepe can go see their grandkids, they won't have to walk a half a mile, move that parking lot. And if the ball field and the tennis courts go down to where middle school is now, it couldn't possibly stay as city-owned land. Mm-hmm. I mean, would the state pay to put a ball field on city-owned land if the city is giving up?
Very, very possibly. I got to go ask them, but very possibly. But that's the part where they say they're looking for a partnership. They want to work with the city of Caribou to make sure that you get what you think you need. They're going to make a major investment in this project. It's going to be tens of millions of dollars, and they want to make sure that they're going to build the best facility they can educationally, but they also want to make sure that the city of Caribou is happy with its location and with the amenities that it offers the city of Caribou.
So I have one last question. Do you know if the National Guard is moving out of that place?
I don't. Nobody, we haven't asked them to move out. We did look at, I think I mentioned that, one of our test fits, we did look at the possibility of moving the National Guard out. On that particular test fit that I showed you, we didn't ask for that to happen, but if that land's available. The Department of Education asked me the same question last Thursday. They said, what about that land behind the Wellness and Recreation Center? Would that be a good place for a park or a good, they were thinking about, well, what if you move Teague Park? They said, well, should Teague Park move behind the Wellness and Recreation Center? I said, I don't know. I haven't been to see the city council yet. So I don't, you know, we haven't explored that possibility. But maybe Austin can, has any information.
I have a comment from the National Guard as to whether or not they're going to move or would be willing to move.
I have just one more little quick question. You said that there was no time limit, 60 days or whatever. But is there a chance that we would lose our number 10 spot? We're up to 20, we're up to 50. We didn't hurry along and...
No, I don't think you have to hurry along. I mean, the Department of Education doesn't really care if this referendum happens in November of 2016 or June of 2017. You can't wait 5 years. I mean, at some point they're going to get frustrated and they're saying, you know what, you're not interested in the money, so we're going to give it to another community. So does that help?
Yep.
Okay. Great.
When you go through those.
Just yep. one comment yep. on that. I think it's every
6 to 8 years they put another list out of schools.
Okay.
And if you get to that point and you haven't done anything, then that money will go to that school. Yeah.
We can probably do it within that time.
So in the process of going along and then the straw polls and whatnot and then trying to make everybody happy on the deal and it gets to the point where it isn't something that anybody wants or the majority doesn't want, what happens then?
Oh, you mean if you take it to the straw poll and 70% of the people say voted down and say no, we think that's a terrible site. We go and look at it. We listen carefully and say, why is it a terrible site? What were the objections that people raised? And the building committee would go back to the drawing board. But if 70% of the people say we definitely wanted it at the high school site, there would be a lot of discussion at the straw poll meeting, explaining why we looked at that and why there wasn't enough land there. So it's one thing for people to say they want it somewhere, but the question is, can you make it work? And will it be viable?
One last. The Teague Park Playground is not locked. It's open to the public, even when school's not in session, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
It's not?
It's not when it's in session. It's not open to the public.
Right.
There, we have an MOU with the school when they, when the school became an RSU, because that property became school property prior to the RSU becoming an RSU. That property at Teague Park was City of Caribou property. Now that it's RSU, we have a memorandum of understanding with them that when the school is in, it's not open to the public.
Let's
but it's not like during summer, summer
right,
stuff.
What about at 4 o'clock today? Could some, could the public use Teague Park after school?
Yes.
Okay. So, I mean, we could make agreements like that again. I don't see why that's a big deal.
And if the process isn't...
There'll be building.
It can be stopped at some point, as you had mentioned. You know, if it was 70% of the people said no, you could...
Oh, if we got a, if we did a straw poll on this site and 70% of the people said no, we're not, we're going to vote it down?
Yeah.
The state would not let us go forward. They would say, you've got to go back to the drawing board.
So there's some assurance there.
Yeah. I mean, the state is, the state encourages community participation. And personally, I know you've raised some good questions, like why didn't we come to the public earlier and ask them their opinion about the site? I think when we go, my experience has been that when you go to somebody, you want to go with some kind of a plan. Don't go with just an abstract idea. And so what I've presented with you tonight, you may not like.
That was not my point. My point is, when you have what you have here now, why didn't you go to the public and say, you know, have a public meeting and talk about and tell them what you're telling us?
We will.
A lot of people should.
Yeah. Well, we will, and hopefully a lot of people will come out.
That's just not the process.
That's just not the typical process. That's right.
Any other questions?
I guess
anything else you want to add here?
Well, I guess one of the things, you've given me some good feedback, but one of the more information the council can give us in terms of your feeling about the sharing of the land and changing the ownership of the land, the more useful it is to us. We don't want to continue to spend time and money looking at this site if the council feels strongly that they don't want to relinquish Teague Park land and they don't want to relinquish the swimming pool land.
Could you put your map up again with A through F and right there? Yeah. I mean, you're going to go from one field to five fields. My biggest concern with
some of those are those elements we talked about.
No. My biggest concern is what's left for the Wellness Center in case someday we do want to expand that thing.
It's all this. And all that property is there, that footprint for the Wellness Center.
There's a splash pad in it now. No, but the point is, well, I'd like to hear from Mr. Markey.
What's that, Mr. Markey?
Could you live with that? I mean,
what I suggested in a couple meetings is I really do not want to relinquish this piece of property to the IRCU. North Street is about here, where North Street is located. I would feel, and this is just my opinion only, I would feel comfortable from here north selling the piece of property for the pool by relinquishing, keeping all of this piece of property to the City of Caribou. I really think that they can build a school in what they're taking up from, you know, where North Street is located. We're looking at about less than 100 feet. Our tennis court would stay, our maintenance shed would stay, utilize North Street as the divider and build to the north, and then we keep this remains City of Caribou property.
What if you traded what you have now with the middle school site? It'd be about the same size.
I mean, this piece of property is still bigger than this piece of property.
Well, the street, if Park Street's gone, you can take a little extra. My biggest concern is around the Wellness Center. Would you ever think you'd need more land?
Potentially. I'm not sold on this piece of property right here. That's our overflow parking right now. And we all know that when we have special events, this piece of property is well, well used.
Yep.
It's full.
Yeah.
So this is not the best location for an aquatic facility. Now, if the talk was this was going to be removed, potentially, but I don't believe that this place is going to go anywhere anytime soon.
What about where the middle school is? They've got that into three fields. What if we just had, what if we just gave them two fields there?
I think the biggest question is the ownership of the property. That's where I would really, really have, we're home on this property. Whether there's an MOU stated, school boards change, people change down the road, who's going to maintain it? Who's going to keep it up? It's our property now. I would really like to see this property continue to be here. If they want to tear down the middle school and build something over here, that's fine. That can still be RSU. It's not our property now. But I would really, really, and I've made it clear that you can cut North Street down in half, Teak Park in half, and this remains City of Caribou, and then purchase the pool property, and we're going to have to find another home for the aquatic facility.
So ball field will remain as it is anyway, right?
And then it is, but it wouldn't be under our...
Wouldn't be under your own...
Under the City of Caribou's ownership.
So you never take these, like the top two choices, and take those to the next step? You just take the top pick?
Yes, because it costs money to keep moving forward on both sides.
Sure does.
And so the state's interested in having a streamlined, efficient analysis done. One of the strengths...
What are the property issues? Hilltop is number two. What are the property issues with Hilltop? Are there any?
Hilltop could use a little more land. It's a little tight. Could use a little more land, and Carl Soderberg does own the parcel behind the Hilltop School, and he's offered to sell us additional acreage there. A lot of that acreage is not useful. There's a lot of steep slope that goes down the back, but there is about six or seven acres that could be useful for the school. The building committee and the scoring here, the scoring essentially scoring was good on this site primarily because of the Wellness and Recreation Center.
I'm sure the Wellness Center is a...
It's a big... It contributes a lot of... right, and I would encourage the council and members of the public that are watching this to sort of sink their teeth into understanding how valuable these programs are for these kids. And the other thing is that right now these kids can walk to this.
That's one of the problems, though. We all know how valuable the programs are, but now you're taking away some of the possibilities of places where we might want to expand the programs in the rec center. With Teak Park, I totally agree with what Gary said. You can't put the pool or the splash pad or whatever beside that wellness center because, never mind major events, there's days I drive by there, there's a lot of people parking in that side parking lot. Because there isn't that much parking out front of the Wellness Center. And, you know, I just put a splash pad there.
Well, the sense of the building committee, in our sense, was that these two functions together make a lot of sense, that this would make a very strong social sense. And the Department of Education would bring a lot of dollars here to make improved athletic facilities. So if that's not valuable in the long run to the City of Caribou and to the Wellness and Recreation Center, then we probably will end up going to a different site. But it seemed to us there was a good synergy by having these two institutions right next to each other.
Councilor McDonald.
Will that fit at Hilltop?
Not all of this stuff. But we can get two fields, and we get two fields at Hilltop. We can build two fields.
Now, is two fields enough?
Well, on this plan, we're building three or four fields.
But
two.
Do you need three or four?
I'm going to...
That's why I asked that, because today we're accommodating them, you know, with one place really, and what they do use over at the park, all right? And all these fields are nice, but do we really need them? I think, to me, I don't like spending money, whether it's the state's money, my money, or your money. And I think that if we have the necessities without going beyond, in other words, if the population requires two fields, then why aren't we presenting just two fields? That's all.
Every time we cut a dollar from the education budget, we've saved 25 cents. I worked for the school department for 38 years, and I've been on this council for 8, and I don't see where either group can't get along. I think there's, we just don't trust each other here. I don't know what the, I mean, I think we can get along. We all live in the same town, and it's, I mean, even if it's RSU or city, it's Caribou land.
What about the two fields up there by the rec department, okay? What if that, instead of fields, that became part of the came the park? And then that would give you room, Gary, to not only have the parking, but maybe expand at some point in time if you needed to for an aquatic whatever. If you did that and kind of swap Teague Park down there for that up there, and the park that goes with the recreation department, and then we move that down there. If we could get rid of, if we didn't need those ball fields, if we could move them somewhere else or do without them, I think that would be a good compromise right there. And then you would have the room that you needed for the rec department, the parking, any activities that you want to do that the park would do, like when the church has their little bazaar and stuff like that in there, and things like that. That to me looks like a good compromise right there, and then you've got the best of both worlds.
I think it's a good suggestion. That's the kind of thing I was hoping to hear when I came to you folks. I mean, I'm trying to be clear that this isn't cast in concrete, and we're here to see if if the council wants to work with us to develop this site. And then there are opportunities like that. You know, the Department of Education wondered if this could be the park. The Department of Education wondered if this could be the new Teague Park, and now you're saying maybe this becomes the new Teague Park.
I'm thinking, because if you don't know if the guard's going to vacate or not, and you can't count on that. If they did, great, but if they don't, then you'd have that area right there,
right?
And that could become the park, so we wouldn't, and then we could kind of maybe swap or something like that.
Would it make sense, if we're going to work together, would it make sense to go to the guard to see if it's possible for them to move?
Good luck.
Is the council willing to ask the guard?
Doesn't hurt to ask. I don't know if we'll get anywhere, but
we can ask them. I mean, that.
Yeah.
Can you kick them out?
No, not politically.
Oh, that was. I take that back. I'll scratch that from the record.
The unit up front, the maintenance facility for the National Guard.
This one.
Yeah, that was pre-existing. And then the 133rd came to town, and they wanted more space. They wanted to build a climate-controlled building to store their vehicles in, back there where you've got the field behind FM5, okay?
Up in here?
No, to the left, right there. That's currently fenced in, and they're parking some vehicles.
That's right.
There.
They have fencing like this on the RSU land.
And when they put the fence up, they overextended their boundaries from what we allowed them to do. I do know that. Well, I think that's the 133rd, and is the FM5 associated with the 133rd, or are they a separate entity? I mean, I understand it's still all God and everything like that, but the 133rd sounds like they may be moving. So if they move, they'll probably take all their stuff with them. Just saying, I'm hearing those rumors.
Well, in terms of long-range planning, and the way we approached this was we took liberties here, obviously, artistic license, to think about master planning the whole parcel. But we're master planning somebody else's land, which is your land. We thought these two institutions working together, using all of this land, would make for a really good long-term program for the next 40 or 50 years. So I can't speak for Gary and for the Recreation Department and what their long-term plans are. I know this is a future expansion here, but it seems to me that it would be in your best interest to think about how you wanted to master plan this parcel as well. And maybe there is some land swapping that happens between the RSU and the city of Caribou to make things work better for the Wellness and Recreation Center.
When the letter C for city of Caribou, that parcel there of T Park, what was the acreage on that? Oh, I didn't catch it earlier.
6.6.
There has to be a way to, some sort of way to come to a common ground between that satisfies 80% of the.
What's the size of that RSU piece on the other side of Bennett Drive?
6.3.
I think that would be a good way to do it. And then that land goes with the school. That land goes with the.
I mean, I'm sure it's possible that, you know, somehow it can be worked out. Obviously, the interest, at least I think the interest from all of this council is going to be, what is it going to cost the city when it's all said and done? And I mean, if we're just talking swapping the land or something, we know there's buildings on that site across the road. Would that be part of the project to demolish them if the land is going to be given to the city? Construction of the ball fields and so on. I mean, there's costs involved in all of these things. So, you know, as I say, I'm sure something can be worked out, but at the same time, I know the city is not in the position where we get a lot of extra money. We can just throw out there and make a bunch of changes to things. And but as far as working with the RSU and so on, look, I don't see that as a problem. I don't think that's ever been a problem from our end. May have been a problem from the other end, but it certainly hasn't been from our end.
Well, great. Well, I guess what I'd like to do is to continue to come before the council. Maybe we'll try some more test fits. We'll go back to Department of Education, talk to them some more. If there are some members of the council that want to come with us, you're very welcome to have Austin's on the building committee, but I don't think he's been going to the Department of Education meetings. But if the council wants to be more involved, that'd be great. And I'd like to have the opportunity to come back to keep you up to date on what we're discovering. You've asked me questions about the level of participation from the Department of Education that I can't answer because I cannot speak for them. But I can go back and ask the questions to them. So you've given me some good things to work with tonight.
Do we need a motion for him to do that?
We don't.
No.
No, we don't need a motion on this now, do we?
No.
No. Just we've had the discussion.
He'll come back.
You're going to go and try to do some more possibilities on this and maybe present something else?
Yeah, and we'll I'll present some of the ideas that I've heard here tonight. I'll talk them over with the Department of Education. We'll draw them up, and then I'd like to come back and see the council again.
Yeah.
Great.
All right. Anything else? Any other questions?
No. Great. Thank you for your time.
Are you here most weeks?
I'm here about two or three times a month. I'll be back the first week of October. I don't know. I'll look at your schedule. I don't know. How often do you folks meet?
October, we'll be meeting the second and fourth
five times.
Mondays.
October 13th will be a Tuesday because Columbus Day.
Oh, that's right.
No, we don't.
So I'll come when I need. I'll come when you need me to. You know, I'm here to facilitate and try to make a good project happen.
Used to the superintendent's office?
Absolutely. Yep. Great. Thank you.
All right, number seven is City Hall Projects, Manager Blease.
So last week, Municipal Building Committee met to discuss some of the projects that we should be considering for City Hall. Three main areas that were looked at were heat pumps in the main floor, second floor, and in the dispatcher police department, remodeling the main floor of City Hall, and touch plan the outside of the building. The budgetary estimate we received for remodeling the main floor of City Hall was $106,000. Part of that included $50,000 for electrical and heating that would be part of any remodeling. So this would create four offices in the area currently utilized for vehicle registration. The clerk's office would be opened up and vehicle registration would be done there. This would provide for better workflow and better coverage during breaks and vacations in the clerk's office. It would put the most services that the citizens come into City Hall foremost all on the same level. So we asked for quotes for tuck pointing. Rennie St. Peter gave us a quote of $32,600 for repair and tuck pointing the upper part of the building on the northeast and south walls, removing and replacing the 22 windowsills, and repairing the concrete wall by the police department entrance. The quote for this came in at $32,600. These are the two projects the committee is recommending the council authorize staff to move forward with. We'll work with the mason to get that work started quickly. We'll likely need to get a contact a design professional or engineer to get detailed plans made that could go up for competitive bid on the remodeling project. At the end of August, we had $12,624 in the municipal building reserve account. We'll be moving the $72,687 from the sale of 63 Sweden Street into that building, or into that account as well. Gives us a total of $85,311 in the account. We also have the revenue from the logging that'll be done this fall at the old landfill site. That estimated revenue was $34,380. So we would need a motion to allow us to get the masonry work done, as well as getting the design professional and authorizing the lowest responsible bidder to complete the remodeling work.
Is there any kind of a diagram or anything now of what we're going to be looking at here?
That's what the design professional will be. We have layouts kind of in our mind, but we need somebody that actually can lay it out and propose the work.
Four offices. Who's going to be down in there?
The original thinking is housing, the two ladies from housing, and then the assessing department would be down here.
So how many people?
Four.
I mean, I'm not. Probably have to go out and look again, but just thinking how big that is out there, that's huge.
It's big.
That's huge. Four huge offices. I mean, I'm just questioning whether we need those large in offices for...
If there's extra space, we would probably make a storage area as well. But we need somebody that can lay it out for us and visually see it on paper.
I had a question. The $32,000. Did you get other quotes for that? Just the one?
Just the one. If we utilize the city lift, which we can, that would help reduce some of the costs there.
Did you reach out to anybody else to get quotes on that?
No.
Should we?
We didn't know.
We can if the council wishes. He's the main basin in the area. Pretty reasonably priced from what we've heard from other people.
Just one other quick question to come to my mind. What about the space upstairs when we move these four people down? What's happening with that?
We'd have some storage, and we haven't thought a whole lot about what the extra space...
We're not going to talk about remodeling that next year or something somehow, are we?
It's not on my radar.
Okay.
Remember, we just put a new rug, so it's 20 years from now.
Is carpeting needed?
New carpeting will be part of the budgetary estimate there. Well, I shouldn't say carpeting, but new flooring. Some of it would be
tile. That's good. Yeah, I like that better.
Part of that included the $50,000 for electrical and heating that would be part of any remodeling. Are we talking heat pumps now? Is that what we're talking about there?
Right.
Did we ever do a payback to determine how long it would take?
I don't know if the council did that when they put in the pellet boilers or not, if they looked at heat pumps instead.
Well, the council didn't, but it was done. I don't think it's quite worked out so far, but it was done.
Do
what does council want to do here?
I'd like to make a motion. I was on the building committee. The building committee came up with the assessment. We did question the masonry a little bit, but then when we thought about all the work there, it seemed reasonable. And so we decided that was priority one, and priority two was remodeling down here. So I'll make a motion that we do the masonry work and get a design for the downstairs remodeling.
Second.
So you're just asking for the design on the downstairs. You're not approving the...
No, because if the design comes in at $200,000, we'll probably say, let's get another design.
Just get the design plan, get some competitive bids, and go from there.
Have a building B or something.
Are we authorizing him to spend money to get that design?
Yes.
Yeah.
Do we have a seconder? We had a seconder, did we? Joan? All right, all in favor? Approved? I don't think that price on the tuck job is out of line either, that $32,600. I know what it costs to one chimney, so.
I don't know if it's out of line, but does the city have a policy for procurement? That's where I was going with that.
I've never seen such a policy or been made aware of a policy.
It just seems kind of standard.
You know.
Yeah.
Policy for what? I didn't hear you.
For procurement.
Oh.
Yep. Yep. Just kind of keeps everything out there transparent.
All right. Next item is city-owned property. Manager, please.
City staff has been looking at some various parcels of land that are owned by the city to see why we own the property and if the city still needs to own the property or not. Some of the properties we identified so far include Map 5, Lot 15, off the railroad tracks near Dow Siding Road, Map 8, Lot 20, off the railroad tracks between Route 1 and the river, and Map 36, Lots 104 and 106 off of Limestone Street. The city came into ownership of these properties at various times during the last 20 years. In the case of Map 36, Lots 104 and 106, the city bought the property in the old Caribou Development Corporation, paid to have the homes removed. That was done back in the 80s. We've had interest from abutting landowners to purchase the property that's there today. Staff feels these properties could be sold rather than the city keeping them, and ordinance is required to authorize a sale of any city property, and that ordinance is proposed in the next pages. A public hearing could be held at our next regular meeting, which is scheduled for October 3rd.
I'll make a motion to introduce ordinance number 11 regarding the sale of municipal property.
Second. Oh, we don't need to do that.
Don't need a second.
Did you research why the city bought and removed some houses?
There's no information that we've been able to come up with as to why it was done. The nearest thing that we can guess that would be possible future riverfront development, but that's very far down the Limestone Road. And that's just a complete guess on our part. We have not found any documentation on it.
Aren't these two properties right by where Railroad Street comes into Limestone Street?
Somewhat, yep.
Down by the railroad tracks in that, or are they up further?
No, they're up further.
Okay.
I know you mentioned in here that there's an interest from abutting landowners to purchase the properties, but if we sell them, we would be selling them by bid, advertising the bid.
It's however the council wants to go about selling them. If I want to go up for competitive bid, we can do that. If we want to offer it to the abutters, we can do that as well.
Are they buildable lots?
Do we determine that? No, I'm just introduce the ordinance, right? Mm-hmm. Determine later.
The ones on Limestone Street, if they were combined with adjacent lots, should be buildable. Same with the Dow Siding and the other ones. As they sit today, one of them, I think the one on Dow Siding probably would be, but the rest of them might not be. So if you combine them with the other lots, it would work.
All right. Airport master plan update.
Council's received the updated airport master plan. The plan provides the city with information about the existing conditions of the airport, forecasts of aviation demand, facility requirements, and alternative analysis. The last pieces of the plan are the layout and implementation and financial plan for it. The airport committee and members of the community, including Phil Sear from the planning board and Bill Belanger, both spent a lot of time assisting in the drafting, reviewing, and providing feedback on the plan. committee has sent it to council for their recommended approval. The state's looked at the plan, reviewed it, and approved it. The council needs to approve it as well. The FAA will need to approve this plan, but that will likely take a long time to get their approval. So approval of the plan is recommended.
Seems kind of strange that we do everything here and then the FAA, why don't they look at it before we do and then we say, go for it?
The response I received when I asked that very same question was it could take 5 to 10 years for the FAA to approve the plan.
Well, they require us to do this, what, every 5 years? Updated every five?
This has been since...
Every 10 to 15.
Every 10 to 15 years, and then we approve the tentative update right now, and it may take them 10 to 15 years to go ahead and approve it?
We may have to do another one.
Time for the next one.
Time for another one. That's why I asked that question, because I figured that that's where that was going to go.
The FAA one, is that the one that says there's like 40 planes landing here every day and all that stuff? Is that right?
If you read the report, you'll see where they made some downward projections on that
right.
forecast. Although the report that they submit shows the 4,000 operations, but in essence, throughout the rest of the airport plan, it shows probably what is more realistic to the 6 BA population up there.
We do have two new planes that have recently landed in Caribou that are permanently housed here now. So
we're up to 8?
So we're up to 8?
So I think we'll see an uptick in aviation.
We've already met one criteria.
Wow. I'm still skeptical.
Do we have a motion on this?
Motion to accept it.
Second.
Councilor Smith and Councilor Martin, second. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor? Approved. 16 Simcox Street. Manager Blaze.
At the council meeting on June 22nd, the council issued the findings in order that the house at 16 Simcox Street is dangerous as defined 17 MRSA section 2851. Was required to be secured and removed within 60 days. The owner has not complied with the order and has not filed an appeal to that order either. So now, according to state statute 17 MRSA 2853, the council shall cause said nuisance to be abated or removed in compliance with their order, and all expenses thereof shall be repaired to the municipality by the owner. According to DEP, we would need to have this building inspected by an asbestos consultant, and any asbestos that may be found would need to be taken care of. After that, we would need to go out for bids to have the building demoed and taken to the landfill. So I'm asking for council authorization to get the asbestos inspection done and to go out for bids for demolition of the building.
Question? For the DEP, mm-hmm. I know that we had a discussion about this the last meeting or at another meeting, that it was a requirement if the city owned it. The city doesn't own this property yet. So why would we have to go through that?
I asked that same question because it didn't make sense to me because it's still privately owned, but because the city, they look at any building owned by the city or any building to be taken down by the city as a commercial building. So we have to go through that process.
What are the odds we get paid by this person?
If we don't, we end up taking the property on back taxes.
No, but does this person own other property in the state of Maine?
Own the apartment building just to the west of this one.
And is it a decent building?
I'd go look at it.
It's occupied.
No,
it's
my occupied. My point is, can we seize that building if he doesn't pay for this?
The tax law.
Right. That's the response from the city attorney. We've asked that question before. That question's come up previously.
Jones asked about mechanics.
Mechanic liens and stuff. I still don't see why you can't
right.
do that.
State law doesn't allow it. This is the only...
Isn't the time we get that law changed?
We could get our state representatives to sponsor such a bill.
Have you asked?
Hey, they'll sponsor just about any bill on the road, so...
Have you asked on that one?
We will...
It's not there.
We'll add this one to our list.
Can we say, could you attach this? You know how they attach bills?
Right.
To things?
Yeah.
Okay.
The question about the DEP thing is we don't know if it's going to, where it's not a commercial deal, it might be a...
We have to do the asbestos inspection because the municipality would be the one taking it down. I don't believe there's any asbestos there, and if there was, I think most of that would have been considered.
Six layers of paint down.
How much for the assessment?
I haven't gone out for, I don't think it would cost too much. We haven't investigated prices.
What's not too much? $1,000?
Under three.
Under three. What would it take for a code enforcement person to get a certificate to be able to do this? I mean, if this is, after a while, it adds up. Is that a possibility?
Potentially, yep. We can investigate the cost of that once we get a code enforcement officer full-time.
This is just going to be another, like, I know where you're coming from, Councilor Smith. It's going to be another $20,000 like we're doing on the River Road.
But this will be all placed back into the property taxes. We might end up acquiring the property. It's the risks the council is aware of anyway when we go for a dangerous buildings order, is that we'll be on the hook to actually get the work done. And if we don't want to follow through with that order, then we might want to revisit whether or not we even go through with the dangerous buildings acts at all.
Yeah. So we haven't acquired this building yet?
No.
And if we take it down now, it's just going to go against the tax bill, and we can still get stuck with the bill.
Right.
Tax acquired.
But it is a dangerous building.
So.
Should let it burn.
When does that come up for tax?
It's 3 years after liens for. Sorry, it'd be 3 years after the commitment date, essentially. So it'd be November of 18 if they didn't pay their 2015 taxes.
Okay, so they're current.
They're current.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think there's much question though. Once you take the building down, they won't be paying any taxes anymore. So.
Yeah, no, that's not the point.
No, I know, but I'm just saying.
Well, if we do the asbestos inspection and go over bids in the demo, don't demo it, can you still put the asbestos bill back on that?
Yep.
So moved.
Second.
Councilor Martin, seconded by Councilor McDonough. To go ahead with the asbestos inspection and get the code on demolition. All those in favor? Opposed? You get. One note, yep. Okay. 2016 budget.
Staff has begun to work on putting together the initial request for the 2016 budget. Before we get too deep into that process, we wanted to hear from the council a bit as to what their thoughts were for where they would like to see the 2016 budget come in. With an estimated 7% increase in health insurance, which has been the 5-year historical average, and assuming a 2% COLA increase, that is approximately $145,000. We need to look at increasing our annual allotment for vacation sick time payouts to at least $100,000 to help cover the anticipated payouts that will be upcoming over the next year. There are certainly other things that could be decreased, but other things that would need to be increased as well. But this is kind of where things sit at the moment. Any guidance from the council would be welcomed and would help to make the budget process smoother as well.
So we're looking at approximately a $245,000 increase with those three things, insurance, pay increase, and sick time.
I mean, there's a lot of things that we're not aware of here yet, though, to, you know, for the discussion. I mean, I think of the CDs that we purchased, for instance, the $90,000 a year towards pension. Well, we weren't paying $90,000 a year to pension before. It's taken up some of the money we were paying here, as well as what was being paid into the state, correct?
We should net about $15,000 to $20,000.
Yeah, so I mean, there is other things to be factored in yet.
Yeah.
I mean, what are council's feelings on that?
I mentioned, well, as an idea, could we have a budget workshop with the city council and the city manager after you get the preliminary?
We have three scheduled.
We have three scheduled for the public. Yeah. Those are public, so we don't do anything.
Council wants to have another one
Okay, that's...
But in order to try and, you know, make the process a little bit smoother and try and come in with something that the council wants to see.
Well, obviously, you know, we don't want a tax increase.
If the council wishes to see no tax increase,
that's
we'll propose a budget that makes that happen. It'll be a reduction in services and a reduction in set.
That's tough working against a 7% increase or 10% increase on health insurance. We're in the wrong field.
Yeah, some places it's greater than that, though.
Yeah.
The first thing...
That's an anticipated increase. It could be more, it could be less.
Yeah.
First thing
yeah,
is
you don't know what that's going
to be. See a sample of the preliminary budget.
Are you in open season right now? Insurance. When is that? November?
November. Open enrollment. Open season is move something.
You knew what I meant. You just embarrassed me in front of all these people.
Oh, you can't be embarrassed.
I'll set the tone. I'm not for any tax increases. Yeah.
I'll agree with that.
Me too.
Isn't that kind of the standard answer every year, though?
Mm-hmm.
I guess so.
Point out
I said it last year. I haven't said it yet this year.
It's my first year to say it, so.
Do it pretty good, doesn't it, Jody?
Yeah.
Whether it's possible.
Whether it's possible, I guess.
No, that's a different story.
I mean, we just... Used to be you'd get increases in revenue to... We want to gain it?
I don't think our state delegation is going to sponsor any bills to put revenue sharing back to where it was either. So,
anybody building anything we can tax?
There are some new buildings going up. Valuation may increase. It's kind of early to speculate as to how much.
More than the ones going down?
Good point.
Bring us a reasonable budget, and then we'll
take
it from there.
He's trying to determine what's reasonable. That's what he's asking you.
Right. Well. He's looking for his wiggle room early.
That's just a tough one with the numbers the way they are right now.
That's tough. That $100,000 for the unfunded mandate, is that the bottom line?
The bottom line.
We haven't put anything in that other than our normal $25,000. And you have brought this to us before, and we've made some adjustments to the policy, but we certainly are not, we didn't adjust ourselves out of that.
No, but there was more put into it last year.
About $580,000, $570,000, give or take a little bit, is where.
I know that, but I'm just talking to facilitate.
Last year we had unspent funds and the council authorized to overspend in that line to have a balanced budget.
Is it 45,000 or something awesome that was put into that?
25,000 is what was budgeted. I actually ended up putting closer to 86 altogether.
Yeah.
Well, I thought the we got $3.4 million from the retirement system and we invested three. I thought some of that was going
to in general revenue.
Put it all in general revenue.
Put everything else to a fund balance rather than designating it to that line because they didn't want to lose sight of the liability.
It's still there.
Yeah, so we could move some of it.
Was it 400?
440.
And there were some possibilities of some buyouts there.
If the consensus is from, or three people say they don't want to see a tax increase, that's what we can propose to the council. That's, we'd rather be able to present a budget to the council that meets kind of their initial thoughts rather than having to go through the rough process of trying to trim everything out in a shortened time frame.
Don't try to take all the fun out of it, Austin.
Austin, take the fun out of it.
So we get a common definition of fun.
What will we do for the next 4 months?
I can think of one.
Wouldn't it be nice if nobody was upset with the council for 2 or 3 months?
Yeah.
Or something? We'd get lonely.
I have a reason to answer the phone.
Any other comments on the budget before we move along here?
Did he get a consensus?
Well, bring a budget and show us what you need, and we'd go from there.
He got the exact, information he thought he was going to get. Let's put it that way.
I'm okay with zero. I just think it's going to be tough to hit that without doing something drastic.
There would be a reduction in personnel and a reduction in services.
Do you have contingency plans on those, give us possibilities?
At this point in time, I do not.
Anything else on the budget?
Every time we ask the public, we survey the public, they're happy with the services.
Yeah.
They're not happy with taxes, they're happy with the services.
That's right.
Every time we try to cut something, the place fills up. And it doesn't have to be anything that big either. So until the public tells us.
Well, maybe it's time that we just started learning to say no.
We've been saying no for 5 years.
Not apparently. I mean, now we're looking at another $250,000. I'm just saying.
Did you know that this...
Some of which is, or a lot of which is from past.
All right. With the present.
With the $400,000, if that would have went into the reserve line, it would have greatly...
But that's
diminished the amount of money that we would need to put
you're entirely correct. But that's money you didn't even know you had.
One-time funds.
We knew we had it. I knew we had it.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Oh. The $400,000.
When did it go down there?
They've been talking about that for a couple of years. I didn't know exactly how much, but yeah. I knew we had a bunch of money down there.
Yeah, but to look and see how much it
and
much
people
it
were saying, let's go get it.
Investment.
And I kept saying, you're going to get a better return from then than you will.
Nobody really knew about that until the last 2 or 3 years.
Right.
So. Some a little sooner than that. But
I don't spend it all yet.
Did you get an answer?
I don't believe I did. I had a couple of no taxes. I had a no tax increase, but tell us what you need.
But I see nothing wrong in taking one-time money and spending it on one-time bills. I mean, we're not creating a program.
Keywords are one-time.
Yeah, well, that's what it is. This $400,000 is one-time, and this unfunded liability is one-time.
No, it's not one-time yet.
Well, working on it.
At one time, there was over $625,000 in that unfunded liability, just so you know, for historical purposes. Wonder what happened to it all.
People retired.
No, I don't think to that much.
Think so.
Yeah, it was.
Yes.
With the $440,000 and what we have in there today, you know, we'd be sitting at close to the $500,000, which would cover us for the next 2 or 3 years. And if we continue to put the $25,000, we'd be fully covered. That's the argument that we made back in
last year.
We were trying to, when council decided where to put that money.
A bit moved around.
Any other comments before we move along? I guess you got all you're going to get.
I don't know.
We'll go with the no tax increase and present the budget to the council and lay out what will become as a result.
All right, other business. Any other business?
No.
Nothing else?
I'm not sure if I misunderstood. I didn't know if I had to do the public input or other business.
Public input. But
I'm sorry. Can I still talk or have to come back next time?
No, I'm going to let you talk. I shouldn't, but I'm going to, because
okay.
I'm in a good mood.
I'm with this, so I apologize.
And I'm done sooner than I thought I was going to be.
Yeah, good mood.
I need to know how we have a meeting with just you guys. My lawyer asked me to ask that my son and I and some witnesses meet with the council on a matter with the police officer. And I didn't know how about to go on that?
I don't First of all, I don't think, if you meet with council, council's normally public session, so is that what you're prepared to do, meet in public, which means anybody else can come in and listen?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. Well, I mean, we could schedule you on the agenda then.
Okay, sir, we appreciate that.
And you can do that through the city manager.
I was thinking they were going to present something in public input tonight.
I didn't know how to do that, and the lawyer didn't know how to either, so that's why we came tonight to see where our steps go.
Okay, well, public input at any council session, you can make a presentation that you want
and
council.
And the next meeting is when, sir?
Is
13th of October.
Okay,
yeah.
We'll present it then, sir.
Wait a minute now.
It's October 13th.
Yeah, it doesn't say so here, but it is.
Okay.
No, it doesn't say so here.
And I finally figured out there's the budget public.
All right.
Thank you.
Three of them.
Yeah, our next meeting is October 13th and October 26th. And budget public forums, October 19th, 20th, and 21st.
And can you let us know when the architects are going to meet in Limestone? Because I think I'd like to go see that.
October 6th.
October 6th?
Yeah. October 7th is going to be in Stockholm. October 8th is going to be in CPAC.
Okay. It's a stupid system, isn't it?
Now, wait a minute. Are they meeting in Limestone with their city selectmen? Or?
They're doing a community meeting in every community.
Oh, okay. So that's not what I... All right.
Can you still just send a reminder out if you want to consider attending?
All right. Can we get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you.